Good afternoon. Welcome back to another edition of the BNH Virtual Event Space. You are tuned into Polar Bear Photography Secrets with the much missed here on the event space because it's been a little while. World-renowned wildlife photographer Roy Galitz. Roy, how's it going, man?
It's going great, actually. Yeah, I mean, springtime's here. Next week, I'm in Svalbard again. So yeah, it's exciting.
Awesome. And today you're taking us on an Arctic journey for the elusive polar bear that most of us will only see through our screen right here, right now.
Well, you're welcome to join, Derek. Everyone as well. Yeah.
I got to come one day. One day we're going to have to do like a live event space and catch out in the field.
That's an idea.
There we go. Well, Roy, I'm going to turn it over to you. Looking forward to this. I will remind everybody that we will get your questions answered. Don't wait until the end. If you have a question during the presentation, Roy always loves taking them during the presentation. So Don't hold on to your questions. A special welcome to everybody joining us in our YouTube audience there. So we're recording live on YouTube right now. Roy, I'll turn it over to you and I'll see you in a bit for some Q&A.
All right. Thank you so much. And thank you for everyone that's joining. Good morning, good afternoon, or good night, depending on where you are in the world. As Derek mentioned, I have the chat box open in front of me. So if you have any questions, I'll answer along the way. Might not be immediately. I might just wait for a little break on the flow. But I'm going to answer, hopefully, everything by the end of this talk. Okay, so without further ado, I'll share my screen and let's start talking about polar bears. So as Derek mentioned, I'm Roy Galitz. I'm a wildlife photographer. Of course, you're welcome to follow on Instagram, Facebook, and all the social media. I have been photographing wildlife for the last 15 years all over the world. Traveling anywhere from the Arctic to the Antarctic and many, many places in between. Of course, we missed all of that during the pandemic, but now finally we can get out and travel and see the world, which is, again, amazing, and I've missed it so much. Today I'm going to talk to you about polar bears. And as I'm sure all of you know, polar bears are only in the high Arctic. So there's no polar bears in Antarctica. People are always surprised to hear about that, but there are no polar bears in Antarctica. And so I'm going to talk to you today about my favorite place in the world, and that is Svalbard. So what is Svalbard? Where is Svalbard? So it's just north of Norway. If you can look at the map, you can see that Iceland is in the far south. Okay, and here you are in New York. This is BNH over here. So Svalbard is just near the North Pole. It's a Norwegian archipelago. It's about 23,500 square miles. There is about 2,000 to 2,500 people living there. The capital is Longyearbyen, and there is about 3,000 polar bears in the general population around Svalbard, out of which about 300 to 400 are resident bears. So these are bears that actually don't migrate and they stay in Svalbard. So my first time in Svalbard was in 2012. And back then I was offered to guide a photography workshop. And of course I said, yeah, because polar bears are very cool. So I guided the photography workshop over there through Fototeva. And we came back, this was my first time in Svalbard. And I came back with many images, but this was my best image. And I know what you're thinking. This was your best image, it's embarrassing. Okay, and I know you're right. It is an embarrassing photo. It's not a good photo. It is the best we could get, okay? So it wasn't good. And I knew that I have to improve. I have to make it better. That trip was not good because it was on a large ship which had over 100 people. And it wasn't good because those ships are very restricted and we couldn't get close to the animals. And of course you have 99 other people that you have to be considerate of. Most of them are not photographers. So I knew I'm not going to make this mistake again. So I've done a lot of research and I've asked around and I looked for advice and I found the right way to do it. And this was not the right way. And if you're asking yourself what's so bad about this image, hang on a sec and I'll show you what comes later. So after finding out the best way to come, I wanted to be there on snowmobiles. So with snowmobiles, we can get really close, because if a polar bear, if you're in the boat and the polar bear is on the mountain, you can't go with the boat on the mountain. That's a fact. And if you're in the boat and the polar bear is far away on the ice, you can't get closer because you can't break the ice. So again, if the polar bear is 2 kilometers away or 1 mile away, that's what you got. This is what you need to work with. And with the snowmobiles, you can drive the snowmobiles wherever you want. And this is a very, very big advantage. So conditions on Svalbard are pretty cold. So temperatures in the springtime in April can drop to negative 30, okay? Which is, again, very cold. And if you add the wind chill factor to that, it's even colder. So, and of course, there are also warmer days like the one you see me here. That was only about 0 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, it wasn't so cold, but it was still, of course, below freezing. So there is no such thing as cold. There is not properly dressed. So if it is cold, you just dress properly. And as you can see here, I'm not cold at all. You can see I'm smiling underneath the mask, the balaclava. Okay, even here in this whiteout, in the blizzard, I'm still not cold. I'm still smiling. So the way I travel around there in springtime is with snowmobiles. So this is a snowmobile, just in case you haven't seen one before. And it's made of two parts, basically. The front, which is skis, which control the steering, and the back, which is a belt, and that actually gives you traction, acceleration, and brakes, which is also important. So that's me driving around. This is my daily commute to work. And the way I go there, I'm actually guiding photography workshops over there. So that's me and three of the guests I'm guiding. And behind us, you can see in the valley down there below in the fjord, this is Longyearbyen. Okay, so that's the capital of Svalbard. And you can see that's me on the right here, and I have my sled, and I have some fuel, and I have some of the necessary emergency equipment. And plus we have two other guides with us that also carry around sleds with emergency equipment, fuel, emergency tents. We have sea ice rescue kit just in case somebody falls through the ice. And we have, of course, rifles, which is a must by the law in Svalbard. So you're not allowed to leave Longyearbyen, the capital, without a rifle. You have to have a rifle, and you have to have a flare gun and a bear spray. This is for protection because polar bears are dangerous. Polar bears are the world's largest land predator, and they can weigh up to 2,000 pounds for males, or about 1,000 pounds for women, for female. That's the maximum, okay? Usually they're less than that. Usually it's about 500 pounds for female and about 1,200 pounds for male. That's, again, that's the usual weight. But usually they don't go to extreme sizes like I've mentioned. So we're driving around the snowmobiles. You can see us driving on the snowmobiles. It's actually a lot of fun, to be honest, as well. So this is, again, the view. This is the traffic we've had. Okay, not a lot of traffic, of course. Better than LA, better than New York. I lived in Manhattan until the pandemic. And of course, we take breaks, we get ready, we get the gear prepared. These are more guests that I've been guiding with Fototeva. And since 2015, this is 2015, I started flying drones in the Arctic. So this is the first time I flew my drone. This was a DJI Phantom 2 back then, with a GoPro camera connected underneath with analog transmission, nothing fancy like we have today. But this is the best we had back then. So there's also a lot of ice caves, which I like to explore. So this is an ice cave, and every ice cave is like a museum of nature. It's just so beautiful and spectacular with the transparent, translucent ice and the icicles. Actually, it felt like I'm looking through a mouth of a shark. So that's pretty cool. But we have to sleep somewhere. And where do we sleep? So we sleep in the abandoned Russian town of Pyramiden. So Pyramiden was founded by the Swedish in 1910, and Stalin later bought it from the Swedes in 1927. And since then, the Soviet Union was in control of the town Pyramiden. At its peak, there were 1,200 people living there, and there is a hospital, a swimming pool, civic center, cultural center. There is the northernmost grand piano in the world. Everything is northernmost over there. But it was abandoned in 1998, and then it was resettled in 2007 with three people that were sent there to live so the place will not be abandoned. And then later they started working to reconstruct the infrastructure of Pyramiden. And one of the things that they have renovated was an abandoned hotel, so we could sleep there. And actually, it's really nice. Okay, of course, you have water and toilet and shower in the middle of nowhere, and that's exciting. So the only person who spoke English at the town was this guy. His name is Sasha. He's a really cool, very Soviet guy. And we were there on May 1st. And if you know May 1st, that's the workers' holiday. So Sasha did a parade all along Pyramiden by himself. So that's a pretty cool thing to see in the middle of nowhere in Arctic archipelago of Svalbard, controlled by Norway near the North Pole. But we're not there for Sasha, and we're not there for Pyramiden. We're there for polar bears. So polar bears are really hard to find. So we go to high ground and we scan with binoculars, and we search the fjord and we try to look for signs of polar bears. So if a polar bear is moving, that's a very good sign. But in case they don't move, you try to look for other hints. One of the first hints we saw was this. So polar bear footprints are very easy to find because they're kind of huge. You can see my hand versus a polar bear's paw. So we see that there is a polar bear around, and we just need to follow the tracks. And we can see that it's very fresh tracks, and that's why it's a good sign that there is a polar bear around. So we get ready, we get the gear prepared, we get the cameras out. Of course, everything is with long lenses. I try to photograph only with 600 F4 with the built-in teleconverter now, with Nikon. And back then I was photographing with the 800mm f5.6, again by Nikon. And today I'm shooting with the Z9, which is, again, it's an amazing, amazing camera. So back then, you see, we have a polar bear. I'm very excited. I got very excited. I'm getting the camera ready. You can see I'm ecstatic. I'm starting to film. And as you can see also, I'm using a video head just in case. I always want to shoot video and stills, so I switch back and forth. And this is why I need a video head, and I'm using a Gitzo tripod. Okay, you can find everything in B&H, by the way. So I'm there, I'm getting ready, and I start filming. And this is what I see. So it's a mother polar bear and a cub. But you can see that they are getting away from us. Okay, so we don't follow them. We don't want to harass them. We don't want to disturb them. This mother has one cub, so she probably had another cub before that as well, and that cub probably have died. So we know that this is a young mother. We know she is stressed. We don't follow her because it will cause more stress. And also, we might, even if we get photos, that would be photos of their behind, which is not their best part, so to speak. So we left this mother alone and we started looking for another polar bear. And then we saw this amazing polar bear. And this polar bear is actually my favorite polar bear in Svalbard. Her name is Misha, aka Frost. Okay, so Misha had two cubs. This is again 2015. She had two cubs, and you can see that she's not afraid of us. She's getting closer and closer. And at some point, you can see she smells something on the ice. So there's a seal's breathing hole, and she can smell that the breathing hole is active. So she's laying on the ground on the snow and waits for a seal to come up and breathe. So this is sea ice. Underneath that, we have hundreds of feet deep water. Okay. The seals swim under the ice, and they need to breathe between 8 and 30 minutes, otherwise they will drown. And each seal has a network of breathing holes. And before they go up to breathe, they stop and they listen carefully. And if they hear anything above the ice, they won't go out of this hole, and not to become dinner, of course, and they'll swim to another breathing hole. Okay, and this is how it looks like when we're there. By the way, I see that there is no questions on the chat so far. If you have any questions, I remind you that you're welcome to ask on the chat. So I'm photographing Misha and her cubs, and you can see how the cubs play together, one's biting the other. And suddenly Misha sits on her behind and she calls the cubs, and they climb on top of her and start breastfeeding. And this is pretty awesome to see two polar bear cubs breastfeeding the twins. I mean, the twins basically. And they're breastfeeding, and the milk that she's providing is super fat milk. So that's 30 to 35% fat milk. So the cubs will grow as quickly as possible. The next thing that happened is another great compliment from Misha. So for me, as a wildlife photographer, the best compliment I can get is when an animal falls asleep in front of me. So after breastfeeding her cubs, you can see that Misha fell asleep. And this is an amazing sign of confidence. And she's comfortable. And when she woke up, I'm getting these nice family photos, which is, again, pretty cool. At this point, I want to make sure that you understand the difference between the first photo I showed you from 2012 and these photos I'm showing you now from 2015. So there is a wrong way of photographing polar bears, and there's a right way to photograph polar bears. And this is the most professional way to do so. And the reason is because the team that I'm working with is the same team that's behind Frozen Planet of the BBC, and they're the same team behind National Geographic Productions and Discovery Channel Productions and a lot of the things, Our Planet, okay, with Netflix now. Basically every polar bear film that you see on TV is done by these guys as a production company. And this is how we're getting such good results, because you need to have someone with experience and you need to have someone that knows what they're doing. And this is really, really important. And that's why I'm always working with the best people in the industry. Okay, you want to get that National Geographic shot, and this is how you get that. So if we have the best team in the world, we'll get the best results in the world. And this is why the previous results weren't good, and this is pretty good. We have a question from the Vimeo. How long did your batteries last in the cold? So batteries, usually depending on the batteries, depending on the temperature, but I did notice, but with the Z9, batteries last me for a full day and even more than that. Okay, so even at freezing temperatures at minus 20, no issues at all with the batteries in the Z9. When I was photographing with the D850 back in the days, I did have to change batteries every couple of hours just because it would freeze. So I'd keep batteries inside my suit just to keep them warm, and I switch back and forth with the batteries. So again, if you keep your batteries warm, you don't have any issues, and the newer batteries are pretty good. And how many batteries do you bring along with you? So with the Z9, I bring two or three, not more than that, just because I never empty a battery during one day, but I always like to have spares. So that would be it. I mean, I have batteries for the Z7 too that I'm using as a backup camera, just in case the Z9 dies. Now the Z8. We have another question from Fairly Arrow. How close can you get before either becomes dangerous or you upset them or make them anxious? So the question on how close can we get really depends on the polar bear. So I'm going to show you more polar bears in a second. But you can see, you'll see that every polar bear has a different personality, different character. Some bears are very nice, like Misha here, and they're very, very comfortable. Some bears are aggressive, and of course, we don't stay around aggressive bears just because they will try to eat us, and we won't let them. So it's not fair, it's just teasing. And if bears are very skittish, very anxious, very shy, usually we don't stick around as well. We keep a distance of 100 meters, 300 feet, or even more, depending on the bear. So the bears usually let us know how comfortable they are. And we never impose ourselves. We never harass bears. This is a big, big no-no. Okay, we never harass bears. We never disturb bears. And we need their approval. Just don't forget that these are real creatures with feelings and emotions and character, and they're alive. Okay, so we need their permission, we need their consent, and we are guests in their home. Okay, this is, a lot of people forget that. I always try to remind people that we are the guests. Okay, so this is really, really, really critical. So the cubs, after breastfeeding, they start running around back and forth, and I'm getting these cool shots of Misha and her two cubs. So they're walking around the fjord, every now and then they stop and cuddle, and you know, like mothers with kids, and kids are kids. Okay, polar bear cubs are adorable. I have this is my weak spot when it comes to polar bears, the cubs. I just love polar bear cubs so much. And then she stops and breastfeeds them again, but she has to eat. And this is her food, okay? She hasn't eaten anything since she gave birth to her cubs in the den. And when she wakes, she gets up out of the den, that's after 5 months of starvation. So she has to eat, and this is her food. This is a ringed seal. And you can see the ringed seal is enjoying the nice warm temperatures. It's minus 10 degrees. And you can see Misha walking around in the background. So the seal is very comfortable, it's very safe. If Misha would start running towards him, he'll just boop, jump in the hole and disappear within a second. So it's very safe for them. The dangerous part for them, for the seals, is when they get out of the breathing hole, because that's when the polar bears will ambush. Once they're out, they're in the safe. So Misha tries to hunt the seals, and the cubs are making too much noise. So Misha is kind of furious, as you can see. But again, this is a photography lesson. So I can tell you that she's not really furious. She's yawning, okay? But one of the things that we do as photographers, we can interpret the scene the way we want to. And I think this is one of the things we do as photographers. So Misha is trying to hunt and hunt and hunt. She's trying to get some food for herself and her cubs, and she fails each and every time. So at this point, we decided to make it make or break kind of thing. And after discussing with our local specialist, production specialist, we decided to try and get Misha hunting a seal. And to do that, we had to get a bit further away. So we were about 100 meters away from the polar bear. We had to get on our knees, and we can't move, because every little movement compresses the snow and transmits the sound through the ice to the water. And then the seal, of course, as I've mentioned, will go to the next breathing hole, hoping not to become dinner. And at this point, not only will I not get my shot, but more importantly, Misha and her cubs won't eat after months of starvation. So we waited on our knees, and we can't move. And the time goes by. In Svalbard, the sun doesn't set between April and August. During all of that time, we have the sun in the sky. The sun doesn't set, so it's complete daylight. So it doesn't matter day or night. Actually, at night, the light is better. So we are there in front of Misha, and we are on our knees, and we don't move, and we wait, and wait, and wait, and wait, and nothing happens. Until 6:49 a.m., when I hear a splash, and I start photographing before I even realize what's happening. And at this point, I see that Misha caught something, and she's pulling it out of the ice. And here I can see that she caught a seal. So at this point, my adrenaline is rushing, okay? I'm not cold, I'm not tired anymore. and I'm getting these shots of Misha catching a seal. So these shots of polar bear catching a seal, this has never been done before. So there's no shots of polar bear catching a seal through its breathing hole, never before. This is the first time in history, which is pretty cool to think that there are still things that haven't been done before. So here I'm with the, you can see Misha catching the seal. She's giving the seal a bear hug. And when she's holding it, this is kind of maternal, like a mother, but it's also deadly because she's killing the seal. And one of the other things that I like about this photo is that it's a lesson. And you can see that the cub is watching, she's watching her mother and she's learning, because one day she'll have her own cubs to feed. And this is why it's super important. And at this point, after she caught the seal, mom, Misha, serves breakfast for the cubs. And this is actually their first taste of meat. So again, pretty cool to see that that she caught it and the cubs are together with her. And yeah, the cub is coming, tells mom thanks after getting the food. And then they have dessert, and after dessert you can see mommy is resting. And then the cubs are going to their playground. So they climb the playground and start running around, getting up and down and sliding. So at this point, we were super tired. So we went to sleep. And after sleeping for a couple of hours, we came back to the kill site. And this is all that's left. Okay, so they ate the entire seal within a couple of hours. Okay, so that's pretty impressive. And that's a 150-pound seal. Okay, so again, pretty impressive. Now I want to show you Misha, the same bear, Misha, and this is in 2022. So this is last year, and here you can see Misha, and she has a cub. So Misha and her cub are walking around, and Misha is, she's different. Okay. And what do I mean by different? Misha is, she doesn't eat seals anymore because there is not enough seals because of the sea temperature rising. So there's not enough seals. So she changed her behavior, and now Misha is eating reindeer. Okay, which is again, kind of unique, because scientists didn't think that polar bears eat reindeer, because reindeer have fat and not blubber. And polar bears need blubber to get the most calories. So Misha didn't read the study, she didn't read the research. So Misha is hunting for reindeer. And you can see that Misha has a young cub, and this cub's name is Frosty. And they're eating reindeer. And here you can see Frosty, totally messy with a little bit of blood on his face. And I wanna share something sad with you. So about 2 months ago, minus 2 days, Misha died. Unfortunately, it was a very unfortunate incident. The scientist tranquilized her, and 2 days later she was still under the influence of the tranquilizer, and she went to a cabin where people were living, and the people chased her away, because that's what they should supposed to do basically. And they chased her away, and she got in the water and she drowned. Again, tragic, she died. Her cub, Frosty, this one, which I photographed last year, he was 5 months old, and now he was 1 year and 5 months old. He didn't leave his mommy, and the people shot him with a rifle and killed him as well. So it is very sad for me to talk about it even, but it is something that happened, and people should know about that. So the reason why they killed the cub is because they thought that he can't survive at the age of a year and a half. But actually polar bears have survived at the age of a year and a half when they were on their own. And one of their example is this photo. So here you can see a polar bear named Grinch. So Grinch is the daughter of Misha. And she got on her own at the year of at the age of a year and a half. That's when a big male came along, and the male chased her away. Otherwise, he would have killed her. And Grinch went on her own path. And that male mated with Misha, and that's how we got Frosty, the little cub. So Grinch went independent at the year at the age of a year and a half. And now, as you can see here, she's 3.5 years old, okay? And she's the brother, stepsister, half-sister of Frosty. And here you can see her. This is, again, from this year. This is a month ago. She's looking at her reflection on the, in the water. Okay, I feel like she's looking and identifying herself or her mother because she's so much like her mother. And she's very playful, like her mom, like Misha. And here you can see her at the edge of the ice. And you see on the right, there is a walrus getting closer. And the Grinch, the polar female, is very playful. So you can see she's curious. She's standing on her hind legs and trying to chase it away. So she's very playful. She's really cool. She's very naughty. She's very unpredictable, like her mother. And she's very comfortable with around people. She's very unique in her behavior. You can see here she's eating kelp, okay? Kelp, like seaweed. So she's eating that. And again, you can see she's so much like her mother. I don't know if you can see that, but she's just like Misha, which is, again, for me, it's so exciting to see that. Although Misha is no longer with us, Grinch and her other cubs that you saw before are still there roaming Svalbard. And Grinch is also eating reindeer, just like mom. So sometimes she's eating two reindeers a day. Okay, so this is really exciting to see how polar bears are. In 2018, I saw this male polar bear walking around the fjord. So he's tasting the air and he can sense pheromones of a female. So he knows exactly where the female is. He knows how far she is, which direction she is. He even knows if she's in heat or not and how much she's in heat. Okay. So this is basically like Tinder. Okay. So he knows exactly where she is. So we followed the polar bear, and this is the beginning of their romantic honeymoon, their courtship. So the female was really tired. She had a headache. So she went to sleep. You can see she's sleeping like this, and you can see the male is like a puppy. Okay, so he's really nice, he's really shy, he's like, oh, come on, wake up, I want to mate. You can see he's really patient. He doesn't wake her up, he's just being goofy and passing the time until she's ready to wake up and finally mate with him. Wow, we have some more Q&A. Furley is asking, is there any human threat to these polar bears? Well, yeah, like I've mentioned before with Misha that died. So that's also one of the threats. Scientists are actually also a big part of that, just because they're tranquilizing a lot of bears, and there have been some incidents. Polar bears are not being hunted by people. But whenever there is an unplanned interaction between polar bears and people, it is kind of tragic for both sides. There have been several people that were killed by polar bears. And after a polar bear eats a person, they usually kill the polar bear just because we don't want polar bears to have humans on the menu. So, yeah. So there is human conflict. Yeah, unfortunately. I answered also the other question. Okay, so let's get back to that. Okay, so after the male is patient, the female wakes up and she's ready to mate. And this is mating. Okay, and this is really exciting just because polar bears mate once every 3 years. Okay, so polar bears mate once every 3 years. And this is why it's very rare to see polar bears mating. After they mate, the male needs to cool things down. So he does this kind of yoga that you can see here. And then they go to sleep usually. Okay, this is how polar bears are in the wild. And then after mating, when the mating is done, each polar bear, male and female, go their separate ways and will never see each other again. Okay, so the female is left to be pregnant and give birth and raise the cubs, while the male goes around doing his polar bear male stuff, basically. In 2019, I saw two males fighting. Okay, so this is the winner of the fight. So males usually fight to for the right to mate with females. So this is why polar bears fight. And this is the winner, okay? So you can see that he has a broken jaw and he's bleeding from several spots. And again, you should see the other guy. Okay, so we are following this male. We know already the procedure. We know that he knows where the female is. We're following the male. And finally, he found the female. This is again the beginning of courtship, of the honeymoon. You can see that this male is a lot more aggressive than the previous male, but the female can also be quite seductive, as you can see here. And you can also see, by the way, the bleeding is still bleeding at this point with from the wounds from the fight. And then out of nowhere, a whiteout came. And when the whiteout happened, everything just turned white. You couldn't see anything. So we're getting this kind of dramatic, minimalistic, fine art images when everything is just white and white and white, which is pretty cool again. Usually in photography, the worse the weather is, the better the photos are. So, and then we get again, mating, okay? So year after year, I'm getting lucky with polar bears who are getting lucky. So again, pretty cool. So, after the mating, they've been doing this several times just to make sure that the female is impregnated. And after the mating, each of them does their own thing. And again, they walk their separate ways. So when photographing polar bears, of course, there is not only polar bears around. There's also Arctic foxes, which are also pretty cool. I really love Arctic foxes just because they're so cute and fluffy and white. And here you can see a fox and a curious fox. We have another question here. Yeah. Richie's tech review. What type of lens is right for wildlife photography? That's a very interesting question, Richie. The best lens depends on what you're photographing, okay? So it's like a golf club. It's not everything's the same, okay? So if you can't get close, I like the 400 f2.8. By the way, if you go to B&H's website and you look at the Nikon 400 f2.8 with the teleconverter, you can see my photos there. So I'm the, as a Nikon ambassador, I'm the one who photographed and did the campaign for that lens. So I really love the 400 f2.8. It's a brilliant lens, brilliant, brilliant, brilliant lens. Super sharp, super light, super handy with the teleconverter. And now I'm also photographing with the 600 f4 with the built-in teleconverter, and also the 800 f6.3, which is also pretty cool and light. But if you ask me what is my favorite, I would say the Nikon 24-70. Okay? Because if you're shooting wildlife with a 24-70, that means you're pretty close. And I'll show you some examples in a minute. But I really like photographing with a wide angle lens. And that way you have the animal and the background together in the same shot. Okay? As the saying goes, if your pictures are not good enough, it means you're not close enough. Okay, so yeah, basically. So, but this is with the 800 f6.3 PF. So again, also pretty sharp, very light, very easy to handle. And as you can see here, you can get pretty nice close-ups. So Arctic foxes are also pretty, pretty cool. So, and this is what it looks like behind the scenes. So, you know, a lot of ice, a lot of snow, and also me photographing. This is a video from last month, and you can see here a polar bear walking around, and again with a wide angle lens. So again, that's pretty cool angle. So with a telephoto lens, you get more isolated subjects. With a wide angle lens, you can get a more open perspective, an open landscape, environmental portraits, which create these kinds of images. And again, this is an amazing advantage that we can get. So I want to show you, before we go to the summertime in Svalbard, because there is also summer, not just winter, I want to show you a video that one of my guests that I was guiding now in Svalbard made. Okay, so this video is done by Lars Bjusker, and he has made this nice recap video of the trip, and I think it's very cool. So he did it last month. Let's watch it. It's 1 minute and something. Okay, as you can see, we're driving the snowmobiles to get closer to our location. This is our convoy, that's me in the back. This is Grinch. See, we're photographing the polar bears, and we're very close to the snow here, just in case we have to evacuate. There is. Yeah, this is what it looks like behind the scenes. We have another question from Ian McKenzie. Roy, how's the color temperature up there? Adjusting it or leaving it to auto? I leave it to auto because I'm shooting raw, of course. The only reason why I'm dealing with the white balance is for the video. Okay, so for video, I would set to either cloudy or auto, but stills, you know, I'm just shooting raw and just measuring it later. So in the summertime, everything has melted. Okay, so we can't drive snowmobiles anymore, so we have to take a boat. But as I've mentioned, getting on a big boat has a lot of limitations, a lot of restrictions, a lot of regulation, which it should, because we want to protect nature and we don't want to 100 and 200 people just, you know, chasing polar bears. So we do go with a very small vessel, 12 people boat, and to find polar bears or any other animals, we basically look at the ice charts. So here you can see me with the local specialist and the captain and one of my guests, and here we are deciding on where should we go. So we are downloading ice chart. This is an ice chart from satellite every day at 4 p.m. And then we can see what the ice conditions are. So polar bears like a real kind of specific kind of ice. So we know that there is a very high likely chance that he will find polar bears, okay? Or he will find polar bears, or he will find polar bears. So this really helps us understand what where the highest probability of finding polar bears could be. Plus, there is a lot of, let's say, regular spots that we usually find polar bears at, because I've been there so many times. I've already been to Svalbard 25 times. So again, I've had my share, fair share of experience over there. And here you can see one of the boats. So, and here you can see also the guests. Okay, so again, this is a trip with Fototeva. By the way, if you want to join me, just, well, you're welcome to get in touch and join me next time. And then when we see a polar bear, we lower Zodiac. So these are the Zodiac. So these are small boats. And then we can shoot from really low. And you can see here that this guy, his name is Amit. And then we can get really nice intimate photos of polar bears. So here we can see a photo which I called it Dreaming of Sea Ice. So again, pretty nice compliment that the polar bear is sleeping, okay, as I mentioned, because when the polar bear is sleeping, we know that the polar bear is comfortable and he's feeling very secure and safe because he trusts us with his eyes wide shut. So again, pretty cool. Polar bears in the summertime eat whatever they can get. So here you can see a polar bear eating a barnacle gosling. You can see in his mouth. Here's a polar bear eating a walrus, a dead walrus, in the water, again from a really low angle, as you can see before with the Zodiac. Polar bears also like sleeping a lot. I have a lot of photos of sleeping polar bears. Here's a female eating a seal. Okay, just she's bragging, so she's sticking her tongue out. And of course, cubs. So here we have two really curious cubs that wanted to get closer. So the best way to get close to wildlife in general, also polar bears, of course, is not to get close to them. It's being still, being silent. Don't move, don't talk, don't do anything. And let them come to you. So if they're getting closer to you, they're in charge, they're in control, and they can choose what is their comfort zone. So if you're very quiet, you could get close up images and you can get really nice, cool results. So this photo was taken with a 24 to 70 millimeter lens. So again, close lens, close distance, wide lens, like I've mentioned, it is my favorite. Okay. Of course, we have also birds over there. So this is an ivory gull. I called this photo Arctic Angel. Here we can see walruses. Okay, so walruses are also pretty cool. And this is what they look like with a telephoto lens. But once you start getting closer, then you can get wide angle lenses. And with wide angle lenses, you can see not only the walrus, but also the landscape around the walrus. So again, that's even better. Getting closer, of course, we do it safely, okay? But getting closer, using a wide angle lens, you can get pretty cool and unique results. Oh, oops, wait, lost my presentation. Here it is. Okay, even underwater. So this is with an underwater housing. You can get even closer with the housing in the water because I'm in the Zodiac. Okay, also bearded seals and Arctic foxes. So Arctic foxes in the winter are white, but in the summer they change their fur. So it's instead of white and long, now it's brown and short. So this is a fox in the transitional phase. So he's just losing his white fur. And then he started running up a hill and he found a pair of pink-footed geese. And he chased them away from their nest. And once he did it, he grabbed an egg. Okay, so this was his nice dinner, but it is a nice dinner for him, but it is the the offspring, the next generation of the goose. Okay, so it's quite sad to see how the parents lost their eggs to the fox, but it is nature, so, and of course we don't intervene. And then the foxes have dens, okay? So they have their dens underneath bird cliffs. So then we know usually the same dens are active year after year for 300, 400 years. So we already know where to look for them. And this is in a place called Alkehornet in Svalbard. And of course, many, 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 many birds, millions, millions of birds. So these are Arctic terns in courtship and raising their young. And of course, we have red-throated divers and puffins and little oaks and many, many, many birds. And of course, can't talk about Svalbard without mentioning climate. So the Arctic is melting very, very fast. The Arctic is warming up 3 to 4 times faster than the rest of the planet. And we can see that in the glaciers receding. And we see that we have less and less ice every year. And this is why we can see a lot of bears that are starving or reducing their activity. And here we can see a bear that I photographed last year. And this bear, you can see she's really sad. And her fjord is all melted away and there is no food around. And she hasn't eaten anything for a long time. And when the cubs wake up, usually they go to breastfeed. But at this point, they didn't. They didn't. And when the mother stood up, I could see how skinny, how thin, how starving the mother is, how starved she is. And her milk has dried out and she couldn't breastfeed her young cubs. And at this point, we left her. So we didn't stick around just because we didn't want to add any more stress by mistake, by accident. So we just left her and let her be. And we went to see another polar bear. I got a message on the satellite phone 2 days after this photo was taken that the two cubs have died. And the mother has survived. She went and ate a carcass of a walrus. So, I mean, this is nature. Sometimes cubs don't make it. And the statistics is that 3 out of 4 polar bear cubs don't make it to the age of 2-year-old. So only 1 in 4 will survive to the age of 2. And that's when they go on their own and then they're adults. Okay, so this is part of the statistics. And of course, just to show you how warm everything is, you can even swim in the water. It's just above freezing, a little bit above freezing. And of course, you have also a lot of plastic over there just being carried around with the current. So you can see polar bears with fishing nets and crates and plastic bottles and ketchup bottles and shampoo bottles. I've seen everything. Terrible. And this is one of the reasons why I'm doing also a lot of campaigns with Greenpeace to raise awareness for the Arctic and the threats that the Arctic is encountering. We have a question from Richie again. What are the best framing for wildlife? So framing, I mean, again, depending on what's the story you want to tell. So for me, photography is about storytelling, okay? So you want to tell a story, and the framing, again, you could have it tight and isolated as a portrait. You could have it wide and show the surroundings and the environment as well. So it all depends on what you want to get and what your surrounding looks like. And if you can get close and do that with a wide angle lens. Okay. So basically that depends. We have another question. Do you have to consider direction of the sun and other factors? Of course. So because the sun doesn't set, so it's just going in circles around us. So in midnight, it's in the north, at noon, it's in the south. So I always try to position the sun in either 45 degrees or 90 degrees from the subject or even behind, okay, and get some backlight, which is my favorite. I don't like photographing with direct sunlight. So I always side or back just because it's white on white. So this is a big thing that I'm doing. And I'm also trying to get backlight and have a dark background behind the polar bear so I can get that contour of the polar bear. So again, I really like playing around with light, and I think this is one of the key things that makes a wildlife photograph good. Okay, it's basically photographing is about all about light. So my footage, my films, and my images have been in countless places and hundreds of magazines, as well as BBC films. So this is a part of the BBC film called Snow Bears. I can't show it here just because of copyright violations with YouTube, but this is my footage, okay? Because YouTube registers it as part of BBC. Okay, so that's why I won't show it here. But if you like, you can write Snow Bears trailer or Snow Bears BBC, and then you can see this trailer and you already recognize Misha and her two cubs. So it's a pretty cool thing to watch. So it's really awesome to see when photos that and experiences that you've had in one of the most extreme environments on Earth come together and being published in magazines and movies and et cetera, et cetera. So my images have been all over the world. I have been giving talks on polar bears and the Arctic everywhere. I've done 3 TED Talks, and I also gave a talk in the United Nations in New York, and New York Climate Week, and many other locations. So I think the power of photography in telling a story about endangered animals and the threats they encounter, I think this is one of the things that drives me the most, to be their voice, to tell their story, just because no one will hear about it. And this is why I encourage everybody, photographers mostly, because we all tell stories, to go to these places and also become ambassadors and tell their stories of the polar bears. So polar bears are amazing. They're really creative. They're really curious, and curiosity is one of the first signs of intelligence. And this is, they're intelligent. I mean, this polar bear, as you can see here, he saw me photographing and he was curious what the camera was. So he chased me and the guest that I was guiding away. And we didn't have time to take our cameras with us. So he just came, had a look at the camera, just understood that it's not food and not interesting for him. And he just went away, kept dealing with his day. So again, polar bears are awesome, full of surprises. Every polar bear has their own personality. And this is one of the reasons why I love them so much. And this is one of the reasons why I've been there so many times and going again and again and again, as much as I can, just to be there and tell their story. And of course, you're welcome to join me and be there as well. So we're going to have, now it's exactly past the hour. So you're welcome to follow on Instagram and Facebook and visit my website and contact me through email or social media. Okay, so feel free to do that if you have any other questions or you'd like to join. And if we have some more time for Q&A, we can do that a little bit before we wrap this up. We have a question from Fairly. I would love to chat at some point if you're okay. So there's another, it's not a question, it's just a suggestion. Fairly, just contact me through social media, whatever. So thank you so much, the guests of the BNH and the production of BNH. Thank you, Derek and Danny. It's always a pleasure to be here with you. If we have any other questions, do you know from the other platforms?
Looks like we've handled everything for now. We'll give you guys another minute if you guys do have any questions. Sometimes I know you get so immersed in the content and watching that you don't think of the questions. But Roy, always good, man. You always deliver a ton of solid information, inspiring imagery. So I want to thank you. It's always good to have you on.
Thank you so much, Derek.
Well, we gave you guys a chance, but now it looks like our time has come. But Roy, we did get a fair amount of questions in there. So I want to thank you again. And we look forward to seeing you back on the channel, hopefully in the near future. I know you're always running around the world, so whenever we can nail you down, it's always a good thing. But huge thank you to Roy again for joining us, to all of our viewers out there. Thank you. And Roy, best of luck on your upcoming travels, and we'll be in touch.
Thanks.
Awesome. Thank you. That is it. That's all we have for now. Another rendition of the B&H Virtual Event Space is in the books. We'll catch y'all next time.